one basic session in which, you know, we did some stuff, and I'm assuming you would have seen through that stuff and would have felt comfortable with all of it. I also gave a problem in the last class. I do not know if you have attempted that problem or not. Have you? Have you been able to solve that problem? No? Okay. We'll look into that problem. I'll visit that problem one more time. But what I want to do today is give you some rudiments of polynomials. All right. Now, what's a polynomial? Something like this. A naught x power n plus a 1 x power n minus 1 plus a 2 x power n minus 2 up to a n, where n is a whole number. It can assume values like 0, 1, 2, 3, etc. Then such a formation is called a polynomial of degree n in x. What is it called? It's called a polynomial of degree n in x. And it's an expression. It's only an expression. The value of this expression depends on the value of x that we assign to it. Yes or no? Say, so I designate it by a symbol called f of x. F of x really means that it's an expression whose value will depend on x, whose value will depend on x. Now, if I say f of 0, what it means is, f of 0 means the value of this expression, that is this expression at x equal to 0, at x equal to 0. For example, if you plug in x equal to 0, you get 0, 0, 0, 0, you get a n, right? If I say f of 1, what f of 1 means? The value of this expression at x equal to 1, put x equal to 1. So that's a naught plus a 1 plus a n. Right? F of minus 1 means what? The value of this expression at x equal to minus 1. This is what it means, right? So f of x means an expression whose value depends on x. An expression whose value depends on x. Loosely speaking, you know, I cannot give you too much of details right now, but sometimes we also call it a function of x. There is a lot more about function. It's a function of x, means its value depends on x. Its value depends on x. Now, something like this, for example, say f of x is x 2x plus 3, for example. Is this a polynomial? Yes. It's a polynomial of what degree? Degree 1. Because the highest power of x is 1. If you have to figure out the degree of the polynomial, if you have to figure out the degree of the polynomial, you look at the highest power of x in the polynomial. The highest power of x gives us what? The degree of the polynomial. So the degree of the polynomial is the highest power of x that appears. The highest power of x that appears in the expression is the degree of the polynomial. So this is a polynomial of degree n. This is a polynomial of degree 1. Suppose I had f of x is 3x squared plus x plus 2. What's the highest power of x that appears here? 2. So it's a polynomial of degree 2. It's a polynomial of degree 2. What is 3x cubed minus x squared plus 1? It's a polynomial of degree 3. Yes or no? If I had f of x equal to 4, for example. It's a polynomial of degree 0 because it is 4 into x power 0. So the highest power of x that appears is 0. So constants, like 4 is a constant. Constants are also polynomials. They are polynomials of degree 0. Constants are polynomials of degree 0. Now, so if I said in this, for example, if I said what is f of 3, it means the value of this expression at x equal to 3. So that's going to be 3 into 3 squared plus 3 plus 2. This is what it means, right? Now, this expression, a function of x, a polynomial in x, for some values of x, this expression will become 0. For some values of x, this expression will become 0. Say, at x equal to alpha, this expression becomes 0. That means, if you replace x by alpha, the value of this expression will become 0. F of alpha. Then we say f of alpha means what? The value of this expression, that is fx, the name of this expression given is fx. F of alpha means what? The value of this expression at x equal to alpha. If at x equal to alpha, f of alpha is 0, f of alpha is 0, then alpha is called a root of the polynomial. Then alpha is called a root of the polynomial. That means if you replace x by some number alpha, if you replace x by some number alpha and the expression becomes 0, then alpha is called a root of the polynomial. This would mean that a naught alpha to power n plus a1 alpha to power n minus 1 plus a2 alpha to power n minus 2 plus an, that is 0. Then alpha is called a root of the polynomial. Alpha is called a root of the polynomial. Now, say, if I have a polynomial of this kind, 5x minus 7, right? A root of a polynomial means what? The values of x, value or values of x for which the polynomial becomes 0. So in this case, let me find the root of the polynomial. Fx, which is 5x minus 7, will be 0 at x equal to 7 by 5. Yes or no? So 7 by 5 is a root of this polynomial. So f of 7 by 5 is 0. F of 7 by 5 is 0. This is what means. Replace x by 7 by 5 and this expression vanishes. So as you can see, what is the degree of this polynomial? 1. Because the highest power of x is 1. And how many roots does it have? Single root. So a polynomial of degree 1 is of the following kind. F of x is ax plus b is a polynomial of degree 1, isn't it? It's a polynomial of degree 1. And let me find out the root of this polynomial. A root of this polynomial is a value of x for which this expression becomes 0. That means x equal to minus b by a. X equal to minus b by a. So f of minus b by a must be 0. Replace x by minus b by a, this expression goes into oblivion, it vanishes. So minus b by a is a root of the polynomial. Yes or no? Right? So as you can see, this is a polynomial of degree 1. A polynomial of degree 1 in x is also called a linear in x. Is also called a linear in x. A polynomial of degree 1, it's also called a linear in x. A linear expression. It's also called a linear expression in x, right? Now, so very clearly, a linear polynomial or a polynomial of degree 1 will have exactly one root, okay? Say, if I have something like what is the degree of this polynomial? 2. This is of degree 2. A polynomial of degree 2 is called a quadratic in x. It's called a quadratic in x. quadratic in x. Now, in order to find the root of the polynomial, what is it that you do? You equate it to 0 and we find the values of x for which it becomes 0. So let's see what are the roots of this polynomial. X squared minus 7x plus 10 equal to 0. Can you factorize this? Minus 7 to be broken as minus 5 minus 2, right? Or x squared minus 5x minus 2x plus 10 is 0. Or x into x minus 5 minus 2 into x minus 5 is 0. This gives me x minus 5 into x minus 2 equal to 0. Or this gives me x equal to 2 or 5. Yes or no? That means this expression vanishes at x equal to 2 or 5. Yes or no? So 2 and 5 are the roots of this polynomial. That means the value of fx at x equal to 2 must be 0. The value of fx at x equal to 5 must be 0. Yes or no? Right? So a polynomial of degree has exactly 2 roots. Right? It's another issue. Sometimes those roots may not be real. They could be complex roots. I'll come back to that later on. Right? It's also possible that I have a polynomial of degree 2 like this, which is say x squared minus say 2x plus 1. This is also a polynomial of degree 2, right? Do you realize that this can be written as x minus 1 whole squared? Yes or no? So then x minus 1 whole squared is 0 only for x equal to 1? Only for x equal to 1? How is it that this polynomial of degree 2 has only one root? I told you a polynomial of degree 2 must have two roots, but it seems like it has only one root. What does it mean? No. It has only one root. It has, actually we say, it has two coincident real roots. X minus 1 squared is actually x minus into x minus 1 equal to 0. In mathematical parlance, we say the two roots are 1 and 1. It has two coincident real roots. It still has two roots. It's another issue that these two roots are coincident real roots. These are coincident real roots, right? So in general, a polynomial of degree 2 will have exactly two roots. It's possible that they could be distinct, as is the case here, 2 and 5, or they could be coincident, as is the case here. It is also possible that the roots are imaginary. Don't bother about it right now. I'll come to imaginary roots later on. But one way or the other, a polynomial of degree 1 will have exactly one root. And that will always be real. That will always be real. If the coefficients involved in the polynomial, we will assume that all the coefficients a0, a1, a2 are all real numbers. We will assume that, right? So in all our discussions, we will assume that the coefficients ai's are all real numbers. Ai's means it's a generic representation of a0, a1, a2, a3, etc. It's a generic representation of all these numbers. So coefficients are all real numbers. We'll assume that a polynomial of degree 1 will have exactly one root and that will be real. A polynomial of degree 2 will have exactly two roots. They could be real and distinct, as you can see. They are distinct and real, or they could be coincident and real, or they could be imaginary or complex roots. We'll come to that later on, right? Similarly, we'll be able to discover that a polynomial of degree 3 has exactly three roots. A polynomial of degree 4 will vanish for exactly four values of x. A polynomial of degree n will vanish for exactly n values of x. So in a general sense, write down, a polynomial of degree n in x. A polynomial of degree n in x has exactly n roots. Polynomial of degree n in x has exactly n roots. Real or complex? Distinct or coincident? Real or complex? Distinct or coincident? That means, see, is this a polynomial of degree n? It will have exactly n roots. That means this expression will vanish for exactly n values of x. So f of, say, the roots are alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, alpha n are the roots of the polynomial, right? That means this polynomial will vanish at x equal to alpha 1. F of alpha 1 means what? The value of this expression at x equal to alpha 1. At x equal to alpha 1. And that must be 0. F of alpha 2 must be 0. F of alpha 3 must be 0. F of alpha n must be 0. Then these are all said to be the roots of the polynomial. Alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, alpha n. Now, say for example, can I wipe this off? Are you all clear about it? Do you understand the fact that a polynomial of degree n will vanish for exactly n values of x? They could be real or complex. They could be distinct or coincident. Right? See, one more thing that I want you to understand is the difference between the root and a solution. You must understand this. Say if I have a polynomial like this, or let's say I have an equation like this, say x squared minus 2x plus 1 equal to 0 is an equation. Is an equation. This is like x minus 1 whole squared equal to 0. Right? That means we say x is 1 comma 1. This 1 comma 1 are the two roots. This equation has two roots but one solution. We say that this equation has two roots but one solution. The solution is x equal to 1, but the roots are 1 comma 1 and they are coincident real roots. In this case, they are coincident real roots. Right? So all coincident roots are looked upon as one solution. Suppose I have fx equal to x cubed minus 3x squared plus 3x minus 1. What's the degree of this polynomial? 3. Yes or no? This is a polynomial of degree 3 in x, because the highest power of x that appears here is 3. And if the highest power of x appears is 3, how many roots would you expect of this polynomial? 3 roots. 3 roots, right? Now, do you realize that this expression can be written as x minus 1 whole cubed? Do you realize that? Is this not x minus 1 whole cube? Do you all understand why it's x minus 1 whole cube? A cubed minus 3a squared b plus 3ab squared minus b cubed. Yes or no? So this is exactly the same as x minus 1 whole cube. And the expression x minus 1 whole cube becomes 0 at x equal to 1, 1 and 1. So it has 3 roots. This expression has 3 roots. 1, 1 and 1. These are 3 coincident real roots. But how many solutions does it have? One solution, one solution. Yes or no? Right? Suppose I have fx is x minus 1 whole cubed into x plus 2 whole square. First of all, can you tell me the degree of this polynomial? What's the degree of this polynomial? 5. Because, see, when I expand this, the highest power of x will be 3. When I expand this, the highest power of x will be 2, because this will be like x cubed, right? So, yes. So, this will be like, for example, a cubed minus 3x squared plus 3x minus 1 into x squared plus 4x plus 4. Yes or no? When I multiply this out, see, the highest power of x would be x cubed into x squared, which is x power 5. Yes or no? So the terms here would be like something into x power 5 plus something into x power 4, etc. This would be the formation of the terms when I actually open it up. When I expand this expression, this is what I get. So the highest power of x that appears here is 5. So what's the degree of this polynomial? 5. The degree of this polynomial is 5. is 5. Now, let me find the roots of this polynomial. What are the roots? Roots means the values of x for which this polynomial vanishes, right? So let me see, x minus 1 whole cubed into x plus 2 whole square is 0, right? This means like x minus 1 whole cube means x minus 1 into x minus 1 into x minus 1. And x plus 2 whole squared means what? X plus 2 into x plus 2 equal to 0. For x equal to 1, for x equal to 1, for x equal to 1. That means 1 is a root and it is repeated thrice. It's repeated thrice. So 3 coincident real roots, 1, 1, 1. And 2 is also a root, minus 2 is also a root and it is repeated twice. Yes or no? So it has 3 coincident real roots, 1, 1, 1 and 2 coincident real roots, minus 2, minus 2. But how many solutions are there? 2 solutions, 1 and minus 2. It has 2 solutions but 5 roots. 5 roots, 3 are alike, each equal to 1, they are coincident. 2 are alike, each equal to minus 2 and they are coincident. Yes or no? Do you understand that? Do you understand now a very clear distinction between a solution and a root? Right? Now, is this a polynomial? X to power 3 by 5 plus x squared plus 1. Is this a polynomial? No. The powers have to be whole numbers. Have to be whole numbers. But, so this is not a polynomial. This is not a polynomial. Yes. Is x cubed plus x squared plus 1 by x to power 4 plus x squared plus 2 a polynomial? Is this a polynomial? For sure it's a ratio of two polynomials. For sure it's a ratio of two polynomials. What's the degree of the numerator? What's the degree of the denominator? 4. It's ratio of polynomials. Now, write down. Ratio of two polynomials may or may not be a polynomial. May or may not be a polynomial. In this case, it is not a polynomial. In this case, it is not a polynomial. However, ratio of two polynomials may be a polynomial. For example, if I have, say, x squared minus 11x plus 30 divided by x minus 5, suppose. This, for example. This is a polynomial of degree 2 in x. This is a polynomial of degree 1 in x. This is ratio of two polynomials. This is ratio of two polynomials. The degree of the numerator is higher than the degree of the denominator. Degree of the numerator is higher than the degree of the denominator. Now, I want to figure out if this is a polynomial or not. I want to figure out if it's a polynomial or not. Now, see, realize that this can be written as x minus 5 into x minus 6. Yes or no? Can you factorize this as x minus 5 into x minus 6? The numerator divided by x minus 5. It turns out to be a polynomial, a linear polynomial or a polynomial of degree 1 in x. Yes or no? Right? So, in this case, this is not a polynomial. One of the requirements, write down, a necessary condition, a necessary condition for the ratio of two polynomials to be a polynomial, is that the degree of the numerator should not be less than the degree of the denominator. Also write down, if the degree of the numerator be higher than or equal to the degree of the denominator, then the ratio may or may not be a polynomial. That means, you know, if I have something like this, x cube plus x plus 1, what is it, a polynomial of degree 3. Now divided by, say, x to the power 4 plus 3x squared plus 1. This is a polynomial of degree 4, right? If the degree of the denominator be higher than the degree of the numerator, then for sure it will not be a polynomial. Right? However, if the degree of the numerator be equal to the degree of the denominator, it could be a polynomial. For example, say if I had 3x squared plus x plus 1, for example, divided by 6x squared plus 2x plus 2. The degree of the numerator is 2. Degree of the denominator is 2. Same degree. Question is this a polynomial? Yes. Do you realize that this is half actually? This is half, yes. Half into x power 0. Isn't it? You multiply this by 2. Right? This is actually half. Do you see that? Right? So this is a polynomial of degree 0. This is a polynomial of degree 0. Yes or no? However, if I had, say, x square plus 1 by x square minus 1. Is this a polynomial? This is not a polynomial. Why is this not a polynomial? That's a question. Why did this turn out to be a polynomial and this is not a polynomial? So see, realize, better, right? This I could have perhaps written as x square minus 1 plus 2. I write it in terms of the denominator. Can I do this? Can I write the numerator in terms of the denominator? Right? Yes or no? X square minus 1 plus 2 divided by x square minus 1. Right? Now when I divide, this by this is what? 1 plus 2 by x square minus 1. Yes or no? Is this a polynomial? This is not a polynomial. Right? Because you have powers of x appearing in the denominator unhandled. Right? Yes or no? This is not a polynomial. This is not a polynomial. Right? Okay, can you tell me one more thing? When I divide this polynomial by this polynomial, what is the quotient of that division? If you divide this polynomial by this polynomial, what is the quotient of that division? 1 is the quotient. What is the remainder of that division? 2. 2. 2 is the remainder. See, if I divide, say 5 by 3. If I divide 5 by 3, can I write it as 1 plus 2 by 3? Yes or no? Where 1 is what? The quotient. 2 is what? The remainder. Yes or no? Huh? 18 by 5. This is 3 plus 3 by 5. What is 3? The quotient of this division. What is this 3? The remainder of this division. Right? So when you perform any division, A by B, what happens? You have a quotient Q. You have a quotient Q plus you have a remainder R by the divisor B. Yes or no? This is what happens. When you divide one number by another number, you get a quotient Q plus you get a remainder R by the divisor. This is what happens. Yes or no? Any division process is leading to a quotient plus a remainder by the divisor. Remainder by the divisor. So this will always be the remainder. So what's the remainder of this division? 2. 2. Yes or no? Now, in this case, what's the remainder? When you divide this by this, this is like half into x power 0 plus 0 by the divisor 6x squared plus 2x plus 2. Yes or no? Right? So the remainder of this division is 0. However, the remainder of this division is 2. Quotient 1. Remainder 2. Quotient half into x power 0 is the quotient here. What is 0? The remainder. That means if one polynomial is divided by another and if the remainder is 0, then the ratio is a polynomial. If one polynomial is divided by another and if the remainder is not 0, then the ratio will not be a polynomial. Yes or no? Write down. If a polynomial is divided by another polynomial, if a polynomial is divided by another polynomial, and if the remainder of that division, and if the remainder of that division is 0, then the ratio is a polynomial. Then the ratio is a polynomial. Say, if I had say x squared minus 10x plus 3. X squared minus 10x plus 3. Okay. Say when I divide it by x minus 1 for example. And I divide it by x minus 1 for example. I want to find the remainder of this division. I want to find the remainder of this division. Let's figure out what is the remainder of this. First of all, do you all know the long division method? X squared minus 10x plus 3. X minus 1. Do you know how to carry out this division? Do you know how to carry? So first of all, I'll do like an x. Then x square minus x. Right? And then I subtract minus 10 plus 1. So minus 9x. Right? Minus 9x plus 3. Right? And then to get this commensurate, I do a minus 9. A minus 9. So minus 9. So minus 9x plus 9. Yes or no? Right? And 3 minus 9, minus 6. Minus 6 is the remainder. Minus 6 is the remainder, yes or no? Do you all understand this? Right? I could have also, you know, performed a manipulation of this kind. I could have written the numerator as, say, I somehow try to write everything in terms of x minus 1, for example, in the numerator. I try to express the numerator entirely in terms of x minus 1. How do? Huh? Let's figure out. This is x square. What I do is I write it as x into x minus 1 by force. So there is an x square that appears here, but I brought minus x from outside. Right? So if I have brought minus x from outside, I must add an x? Yes or no? This minus x was not there. See, this x square was there, but this minus x was not there. So I brought this minus x from outside. Right? So I add x to it. So when I add x to it, then x minus 10x would be minus 9x? Minus 9x? Yes or no? That'll be minus 9x? Do you realize what I've done here? Right? See, I'm trying to write the whole thing in terms of x minus 1. I'm trying to write the whole thing in terms of x minus 1. So, I do a x into x minus 1 per force, by force. So, there is an x squared. So, x squared was anyways there. Then, minus x, I inseminated from outside. So, this minus x, I add x to this mother expression. So that minus x plus x will get balanced. So that x minus 10x will give me minus 9x. Right? Now what I do is, then this minus 9, again I bring in a minus 1 here. So that minus 9x stays put. I have now brought in a plus 9 from here. Isn't it? There is a plus 9 that I have brought from outside. So I must subtract 9. I must subtract 9. So 3 minus 9 is minus 6. Minus 6. And then I divide by x minus 1. Yes or no? So this gives me, when I carry out a division, this divided by this will give me what? X. And then this divided by this will give me what? Minus 9. And then this divided by this will give me minus 6 divided by x minus 1. Yes or no? So when I carry out this division, this x minus 9 is the quotient and minus 6 is the remainder. Minus 6 is the remainder. Yes or no? Clear, no? So do you understand when I divide? And in this case, the remainder is not 0. If the remainder is not 0 of a certain division, then the ratio will not be a polynomial. Right? If the remainder had turned out to be 0, then this would have been 0 and it would have turned out to be a polynomial of degree 1. Now do you also realize this is a polynomial of degree 2. This is a polynomial of degree 1. The quotient is of degree 1. The remainder is of degree 0. Minus 6 is a constant. It's a remainder of degree 0. The quotient has a degree which is degree of numerator minus degree of denominator. Do you see that? The degree of the quotient, as of now it appears that the degree of the quotient is degree of numerator minus degree of denominator. Look at the remainder. It is 1 degree less than the denominator. What's the degree of the divisor? 1. What's the degree of the remainder? 0. That means the remainder would be of degree less than that of the divisor. Yes or no? Try this out for something else. Let's say, for example, all of you, say, I want you to divide, all of you, please divide 3x cube plus x squared minus x plus 1 by x minus 2. All of you carry out this division. All of you carry out this division, both the long method as well as the method that I just mentioned, you know, by expressing the numerator in terms of x minus 2. All of you, please carry out this division and tell me what the outcome is. Method, right? I can see that this is what you did. And just make sure that, you know, all of you got the same answer. 3x cubed plus x squared minus x plus 1. When I divide x minus 2, so then I need a 3x cube. So 3x square. So 3x squared. So that gives me 3x cubed minus 6x squared. And then I subtract. I have to subtract, right? So x square minus minus x squared. That makes it 7x squared. This will be 0. And then I do a minus x. Right? So then realize x minus 2. So I need a 7x. So plus 7x. And then 7x squared minus 14x. Then I again subtract. So minus x minus minus 14x. So 13x plus 1. Right? And then I do a 13 times. So plus 13. So which is 13x minus 26. And then I subtract. So the remainder is 27, as you can see. That means, what's the quotient of this division? 3x squared plus 7x plus 13. What's the remainder of that division? 27. So this division is quotient, which is 3x squared plus 7x plus 13 plus remainder by divisor. Remainder by divisor. So 13 by x minus 2. 13 by x minus 2. I'm sorry, 27. This is 27 by x minus 2. So quotient plus remainder by divisor. Is this a polynomial? No, it's not a polynomial. It's not a polynomial because the remainder is not 0. Remainder is not 0. Yes or no? So even though the degree of the numerator is more than the degree of the denominator, the ratio doesn't turn out to be a polynomial. Also notice that this is the quotient. Right? What's the degree of the quotient? 2. Which is degree of numerator minus degree of denominator. Degree of numerator is 3. Degree of denominator is 1. So quotient is of degree, which is degree of the quotient would be degree of numerator. Numerator. N-U-M-R means numerator minus degree of denominator. Provided degree of numerator is not less than the degree of denominator. Degree of the quotient will be degree of numerator minus degree of denominator. That's the rule. Provided the degree of numerator is not less than the degree of the denominator or the divisor. Right? Also, what is the degree of the remainder? 0, which is 1 less than the degree of the divisor. 1 less than the degree of the divisor. So it turns out that degree of remainder is less than degree of divisor. Yes or no? Do you see that? Degree of remainder is less than degree of divisor. And once the degree of the remainder is less than the degree of the divisor, no further division is possible. No further division is possible. Right? This is important to understand. I'll generalize all these facts. I am illustrating this, but we'll get on to general and mature treatment of polynomials starting from these rudiments. Yes or no? Are you all comfortable with this? Now, if the degree of the divisor is 1, degree of the remainder will be 0. If the degree of the divisor is 2, the degree of the remainder will be 1. if the degree of the divisor is 3, degree of the remainder will be 2. Degree of the remainder would cannot exceed the degree of the divisor. Cannot be even equal to the degree of the divisor. Right? So, just to make sure that all of you got this one right also, 3x cubed plus x squared minus x plus 1, when I'm dividing by x minus 2, I'm seeking to write the numerator in terms of x minus 2. How is it that I do? Okay, I want to inseminate a x minus 2 in the numerator here. So this 3x squared, I write as 3x into x minus 2. So this 3x cubed, okay, 3x cubed. So 3x squared into x minus 2. So this 3x cubed is preserved. Now I have brought a minus 6x, so I must add a 6x. I must add a 6x squared. See, I have brought a minus 6x squared from outside, so I must add a 6x squared plus x squared. That makes it a 7x squared. Now 7x squared, I can write as 7x into x minus 2. So that's this 7x squared is preserved, and I have brought a minus 14x from outside. So I must add a 14x. So if I add 14x minus x, I get a 13x. So plus 13x, and again I inseminate x minus 2 from outside. So 13x was preserved, and minus 26. So I must add a 26. 26 plus 1, 27 divided by x minus 2. And when I carry out this division, this is like this by this will give me 3x squared. This by this will give me 7x. This by this will give me 13. Plus 27 turns out to be the remainder. 27 divided by x minus 2. Yes or no? So this is the quotient. The degree of the quotient would be degree of numerator minus degree of denominator. The remainder would be of degree less than that of the divisor. Right? Generalize these issues, which means, can I wipe this off? So you understand this division. Now, if I have a polynomial of degree m, a naught x power m plus a1 x power m minus 1 plus a2 x power m minus 2 plus am. What is this? This is a polynomial of degree m, isn't it? And I divide it by a polynomial of degree n. This is a polynomial of degree n and x, right? When I carry out this division, and if m is greater than or equal to n, we talk of a division only if the degree of the numerator is not less than the degree of the denominator. That's when we talk of a division. If the degree of the numerator is anyways more than the degree of the numerator, if the degree of the denominator is more than the degree of the numerator, then we divide no further. Then we divide no further. Now if m is greater than or equal to n, right? M is greater than or equal to m, then this will be like, this will give me a quotient q of x. The quotient will also be dependent on x, will be an expression dependent on x like we got, plus a remainder which will also be a polynomial in x. The remainder will also be a polynomial in x divided by the divisor, which is this? I'm not writing this. This is the divisor. This expression is the divisor. Right? So, this quotient will be a polynomial of degree m minus n. Right? Quotient will always be a polynomial of degree m minus n. The remainder would be of degree n minus 1. One less than the degree of the divisor. One less than the degree of the divisor. So the divisor is of degree n, so this will be of degree n minus 1. Yes or no? Do you all understand this? So whenever I carry out a division in which the degree of the numerator is greater than that of the denominator, then it leads to a quotient whose degree would be degree of numerator minus degree of denominator, whose remainder would be one less, will have a degree which is one less than that of the divisor. So if I had say something like 5x to power 4 plus x cubed plus 1, and I divide it by x squared plus x plus 2, suppose. This is of degree 4. This is of degree 2, right? This division will give me a quotient q of x, an expression in x, and this will be a polynomial of what degree? 2, 4 minus 2, right? Quotient will be of degree 2 plus, now the remainder would be 1 less than that of the divisor. So the remainder would be of the form, say lx plus m, degree 1 divided by x squared plus x plus 2. Yes or no? Do you realize what I'm saying? The degree of the quotient would be difference in these degrees will be of degree 2. A degree 2 is a quadratic. A degree 2 is a quadratic in this case. And the remainder would be 1 less than the degree of the divisor. So if the divisor is x squared plus x plus 2, the remainder would be 1 degree less, which will be a linear polynomial in x, degree 1. Right? So the remainder would always be 1 degree less than the divisor. The quotient would be difference between the degrees of the numerator and the denominator. Do you understand this fact perfectly? No confusion on this, right? Now, let me take you to something extremely important. So first of all, just before I do anything, do you all understand? Can I wipe this off? See, what is the difference between an equation and an identity? What's an equation and what's an identity? Anybody? What's an equation and what's an identity? Yes, Apoorv.
Identity is an expression which is only valid for certain. Identity is an expression which is valid for all values of the given variable, which satisfies all values of the given variable. But equation only equation has certain solution of the variables, which only satisfies that equation, that expression.
Right, right.
So not all values of the.
Right. You're right. Sit down. So, something like, say, x, 2x minus 3 equal to 0. This is a condition. This is a condition. Right? Is this condition true for all values of x? No. It's true only for x equal to 3 by 2. It's not true for all values of x. Right? But suppose I had 2x minus 3 equal to 2x minus 3. This is also a condition. Is this true for all values of x? Yes. Right? So this is an identity. This is an identity. So an equation is a condition. An equation is a condition which is true for some values of the variable, let's say x. Whereas an identity is a condition which is true for all values of the variable. Right? Now, when I factorize something, see if I write x squared minus 1 as x plus 1 into x minus 1. Is this an equation or an identity? It's an identity. Because this condition is true for all values of x. You can plug in x equal to 1, 2, root 2, root 3, minus 1, London, Patna, Hong Kong, whatever, right? This condition will be true for all values of x. So this is an identity. If I write a cubed plus b cubed as a plus b into a square minus ab plus b squared. In this case, let's say treat a and b as two variables, right? Is this true for all values of a and b?
Yes, sir.
Yes. So it's an identity in a and b. It's an identity in a and b. So every time you're factorizing something, are you producing an equation or are you producing an identity? You're producing an identity. Very good, very good. So you understand what an equation is and what an identity is? An equation is a condition, not true for every value of the variable, whereas an identity is a condition true for
all values.
all values of the variable unconditionally, indiscriminately. Yes or no? Right? Now, having said this, see, we just carried out a division. Right? We just carried out a division. So, if let's say the numerator polynomial, call it nx. Call it some nx, a numerator polynomial. It will be a function in x. It will be an expression in x, a polynomial in x. Right? And let's say there is a denominator polynomial dx. There is a denominator polynomial dx. When would you divide? If the degree of the numerator is not less than the degree of the denominator. That's when you divide. Otherwise, you don't divide. Right? So, if you are eligible for a division, what is it that you see? That the degree of the numerator is not less than the degree of the divisor or the denominator. Therefore, let us assume that this division is eligible. It's an eligible division. When I carry out this division, what does it give me? It gives me a quotient qx. This is a quotient. What would be the degree of the quotient? Degree of numerator minus degree of denominator. Suppose this is of degree 20 and this is of degree 15, then this will be a degree 5, right? Plus remainder, which will also in general be a polynomial in x, divided by the denominator. Yes or no? What is the degree of the remainder? One less than the degree of the divisor, right? So if the divisor is a linear, this will be degree 0. If the divisor is a quadratic, this will be degree 1. If the divisor is of degree 3, this will be of degree 2, quadratic, and so on and so forth. Now, so this is the quotient, this is the remainder. If the divisor is a linear, then this will be degree 0. Degree 0 is a pure number. Degree 0 is a number, a constant. Now, when I write this, is this an equation or an identity? It's an identity. When I'm dividing, then that condition is true for all values of x. Yes or no? When I'm carrying out a division, say if I'm dividing x squared minus 1 by x minus 1 equal to x plus 1. Yes or no? This is true for all values of x. So this is producing an identity. A division of polynomials will produce an identity. It will not produce an equation. It will produce an identity. Okay. Now, so this is an identity. This is the quotient of that division. This is the remainder of that division. Is this true for all values of x? This will be true for all values of x, right? Now, suppose there is a polynomial fx of degree not less than 1. Of degree not less than 1. It could be of degree 1, degree 2, degree 3, degree 4, etc. This is a polynomial fx. And I divide it by x minus a. I divide it by x minus a. This is a polynomial of degree not less than 1. Because if it was of degree less than 1, that means a constant, then no further division is possible. This is degree 1. So this cannot be less than degree 1. So when I carry out this division, what would it result in? 1, it will give me a quotient. Suppose this is a polynomial of degree n. Suppose this is a polynomial of degree n. And I divide it by x minus a. What will be the degree of qx? N minus 1. Qx will be of degree n minus 1. Plus remainder by divisor plus remainder by divisor. Now, what would be the degree of the divisor?
One less than the degree of the
divisor. Degree of the remainder is going to be? Degree of the remainder would be 1 less than the degree of the divisor. What's the degree of the divisor in this case? 1. So what would be the degree of the remainder? 0.
Or constant.
So in this case, the remainder would not depend on x. Because it's a constant. It will not depend on x. Yes or no? whenever you divide by a linear expression, this is a linear expression, the remainder would be of degree 0. Degree 0 means a pure number whose value will not depend on x. Whose value will not depend on x. Yes or no? Do you understand this? Now, is this an equation or an identity? It's an identity. It's an identity. Yes, it's an identity. Whenever you carry out a division of polynomials, you are not producing an equation. You are producing an identity. So this is an identity. This is an identity. Right? Now, I multiply by x minus a throughout. Let me multiply by x minus a throughout. So fx is equal to x minus a into qx plus r. Is this an equation or an identity? It's an identity. Any manipulation with an identity will still be an identity. So this is an identity. So this condition is true for all values of x. It will be true for x equal to minus 1, minus 2, 2, 3, Hong Kong, London, Patna. Right? For all values of x, yes or no? Now, what is it that I'm trying to find? I'm trying to find the remainder in one shot. I'm trying to find the remainder r in one shot without doing any hanky-panky. Right? So what I do is, let me plug in x equal to a on both sides. Since it's an identity, so I have the luxury of plugging in any value of x that I want because it's an identity. So, if I plug in x equal to a on both sides, then why is it that I choose to plug in x equal to a on both sides? Can anyone tell me? Because this will become zero. This will go into oblivion. I want to find the remainder without finding the quotient. I want to find the remainder of this division without embarking on mission quotient. That's why I want this to vanish somehow. And the way I can cause this to vanish is by plugging in x equal to a. Then x minus a will become 0. So let me plug in x equal to a on both sides. So if I plug in x equal to a on both sides, this will become f of a. Value of fx at x equal to a. F of a. Value of fx at x equal to a. This will vanish. And this will become r. F of a will be r. Which means when fx is divided by x minus a, when fx is divided by x minus a, the remainder of this division is f of a. F of a means value of fx at x equal to a. Yes or no? This theorem is called remainder theorem. This theorem is called remainder theorem. Now, if f of a turns out to be 0, if f of a turns out to be 0, that means the value of fx at x equal to a turns out to be 0. What does that mean? The remainder is 0. Remainder of that division is 0. That means this becomes 0. Then fx by x minus a is a polynomial, then fx by x minus a turns out to be a polynomial when the remainder is 0. And when fx by x minus a turns out to be a polynomial, that means x minus a perfectly divides fx. If the remainder is 0, if the remainder of this division is 0, that means x minus a divides fx. X minus a perfectly divides fx. That means if r, which is f of a, is 0. That means remainder of this division is 0. If the remainder of this division is 0, it means that x minus a divides fx. Fx is perfectly divisible by x minus a. And if fx is perfectly divisible by x minus a, that means x minus a must be a factor of fx. X minus a must be a factor of fx. And f of a is equal to 0 means what? A is a root of f x. Because at x equal to a, f x becomes 0. F of a is 0 means a is a root of f x. Right? A is a root of f x. Which means if f of a is 0, f x is perfectly divisible by x minus a. And when f x is perfectly divisible by x minus a must be a factor of f x. X minus a must be a factor of f x. Yes or no? So far so good, right? Can I wipe this off? Say, if I had 2x cubed plus x plus 1 and I divide it by x minus 2. And I want to find the remainder of this division. I want to find the remainder of this division. So in this case, my fx is 2x cubed plus x plus 1 is my fx. What is my a? A is 2. A is 2. Yes or no? X minus a. So the remainder of the division is always going to be f of a, which is f of 2. Value of fx at x equal to 2 will be the remainder of the division. So at x equal to 2, what is the remainder? 2 into 2 cube plus 2 plus 1 will be the remainder of this division. Will be the remainder of this division. Right? It is not 0. It doesn't turn out to be 0. If the remainder is not 0, that means this is not perfectly divisible by x minus 2. That means x minus 2 cannot be a factor of the numerator. That means x minus 2 cannot be a factor of the numerator. Yes, please ask. Bol rahe kuch? Yes, yes. If f of 2 is not 0, that means 2 is not a root or a 0. See, he is right. A root of a polynomial is also called a 0 of the polynomial. A root of the polynomial is also called a 0 of the polynomial. It causes the polynomial to become 0, so it's called a 0 of the polynomial. So far, so good. Yes or no? So now, suppose I had fx equal to x cube plus x squared minus x plus a. And I want x minus 1 to be a factor of fx. I want x minus 1 to be a factor of fx. That means fx should be divisible by x minus 1. Fx should be divisible by x minus 1. When would fx be divisible by x minus 1? If the remainder of this division, remainder, REM means remainder of fx by x minus 1 is 0. But the remainder when fx is divided by x minus 1 is going to be f of 1. Is going to be f of 1. Remainder of this division, fx by x minus 1 is going to be f of 1. Yes or no? Remainder when fx is divided by x minus a is f of a. So f of 1 is the remainder. When fx is divided by x minus 1, the remainder is f of 1. That must be 0. Yes or no? F of 1 means what? The value of this expression at x equal to 1, which means 1 cubed plus 1 squared minus 1 plus a must be 0. Yes or no? That means a must be equal to minus 1. Yes or no? That means if you plug in a equal to minus 1, x minus 1 will turn out to be a factor of this expression. X minus 1 will turn out to be a factor of this expression. Can I wipe this off? Now, suppose you have figured out. So this expression vanishes at x equal to 1. This expression vanishes at x equal to 1 when a is minus 1. When a is minus 1. That means when a is minus 1, when a is minus 1, then x minus 1 must be a factor of this expression. X minus 1 must be a factor of this expression. Now if you know that x minus 1 is a factor, and you want to factorize this expression, now that you have knowledge of the fact that x minus 1 is a factor of this expression, why do you know that x minus 1 is a factor of this expression? Because at x equal to 1, this becomes 0. That means x minus 1 must be a factor of this expression. Yes or no? Right? So, let me factorize this expression given the knowledge that x minus 1 is a factor of this expression. How do I know that x minus 1 is a factor? Because the value of this expression at x equal to 1 is 0. That means when I factorize this, x minus 1 must appear somewhere in the factor. That's when this could become 0, right? So now, this I can write as, let me write in terms of x minus 1. Let me artificially inseminate x minus 1 in this expression. What is it that I do? I can write x cubed as x squared into x minus 1. Now, x cubed I have preserved. I have brought x squared from outside minus x squared. So, I must add x square. If I add x squared, this will become 2x squared. This will become 2x squared. So, what I do is 2x squared I write as 2x into x minus 1. So, that 2x squared is now preserved. Now, I have brought minus 2x from outside. So, I must add 2x. So, if I add 2x minus x, that will be x. So that becomes x minus 1. The expression remains preserved, right? With this manipulation, given that x minus 1 is a factor, I could carry this out. And now I can take x minus 1 common from the whole thing. I'm left with x squared plus 2x plus 1. But what is this? X plus 1 whole squared. This is x plus 1 whole squared. So this is x minus 1 into x plus 1 whole squared. Got me? Now, so then what are the roots of fx? One is a, how many, it's a polynomial of degree? Three. How many roots would you expect? Three roots. What are the roots? This vanishes at x equal to 1. One is a single root. But this gives me a repeated root, minus 1, comma, minus 1. Two coincident roots. This gives me two coincident roots, minus 1, comma, minus 1. So the roots are 1. And this is minus 1 repeated twice. Minus 1 repeated twice. Two coincident real roots and one root. Do you understand all of this? Now, how powerful is this division algorithm, remainder theorem? So very powerful tool, very powerful tool. Say if I had I had 2 to the power 300. And I want to divide it by 7. I had 2 to the power 300 and I want to divide it by 7. Now after having divided by 7, I want to find the remainder of this division. You know what I'm saying? I want to find the remainder of this division. I want to find the remainder of this division. REM means remainder. Now one way, without doing anything major, when 2 is divided by 7, what is the remainder? What is the remainder? 2. I can't divide any further. This itself is the remainder. When 2 is divided by 7, the remainder is 2 only, right? When 2 squared is divided by 7, what is the remainder? 4? The remainder is 4, isn't it? No? Remainder is 4. When 2 cubed is divided by 7, what is the remainder? 1. Right? Remainder is 1. When 2 to the power 4 is divided by 7, what is the remainder? 2. 16 by 7? 2 plus 2 by 7? So remainder is 2. 2 to the power 5, when it's divided by 7, what is the remainder? 4, 32 by 7, 4 is the remainder. When 2 to the power 6 is divided by 7, what is the remainder?
1.
Right? This is 64 by 7, 9. So 1 is the remainder. 2 to the power 7, when it's divided by 7, what's the remainder? 2 to the power 8 when divided by 7, what's the remainder? 4. 2 to the power 9 when divided by 7, you'll find the remainder is 1. 2 to the power 10 when divided by 7, you'll find the remainder is 2. Then 4, then 1, and so on and so forth. Just check this out. The remainder is 2, 4, 1. 2, 4, 1. 2, 4, 1. 2, 4, 1. They are recurring. The remainders are? Recurring. Yes or no? Right? Now 2 to the power 300 will belong to this family. 2 cubed, 1. 2 to the power 6, 1. 2 to the power 9, 1. And 2 to the power 300 will belong to the family 1, 3, 9, etc. And that will also produce a remainder 1. You expect that. Yes or no? Do you understand that? It will belong to the family 2 cubed, 2 to the power 6, 2 to the power 9, 2 to the power 12. In that sequence, 2 to the power 300 will appear. They are multiples of 3. So that will produce a remainder 1, as you can witness from this. Yes or no? But let me now solve this problem using remainder theorem. Let me solve this problem using remainder theorem. Do you understand this cyclicity? This is called cyclicity of remainders. This is called cyclicity of remainders. Right? Repetition of remainders. 2, 4, 1, 2, 4, 1, 2, 4, 1, etc. This is cyclicity of remainders. Can I wipe this off? Now, see, this 2 cube by 2 to the power 300 by 7, I can write as 2 to the power 3 whole to the power 100 by 7. Yes or no? 2 cubed is 8. So this is 8 to power 100. 7 is 8 minus 1. 7 is 8 minus 1. Yes or no? So this is like, in algebraic notation, it is like x power 100. This is like x power 100 divided by x minus 1. Yes or no? It is like x power 100 by x minus 1, right? So this is like, this is my fx. Fx is x power 100, right? Divided by x minus a, where a is 1, yes or no? Divided by x minus a is 1. When fx is divided by x minus a, what is the remainder? F of a, yes or no? When fx, in this case fx is this, right? Fx is this. When I divide it by x minus a, what is the remainder of this division? F of a. The remainder of this division is f of a. So when fx is divided by x minus 1, the remainder of this division would be f of 1. F of x is this. So f of 1 will be the remainder, which would be 1 to power 100, 1 to power 100, which is going to be 1. Which is going to be 1. Yes or no? Right? Do you see? Clear, no? Can I wipe this off? No, take it. Shall I repeat this one more time? I'll repeat this. See, I'm trying to find the remainder of 2 to the power 300 by 7. This 2 to the power 300 I wrote as 2 cubed whole to the power 100 by 7. This is like 8 to the power 100 divided by 7, which is 8 minus 1. Now what I do is I convert these numbers into an equivalent algebra. I convert it into algebra so that I could use remainder theorem. Let me take 8 as some x. So then, if 8 is taken as x, this will be like x to the power 100 divided by x minus 1. So this is like of the form fx by x minus a. Now it's of the form fx by x minus a. where fx is x power 100 and x minus a is x minus 1. That is, a is 1. When fx is divided by x minus a, when fx, which is this, is divided by x minus a, the remainder is f of a, is f of a. So when fx, which is x power 100, is divided by x minus 1, the remainder is going to be f of 1. F of 1 means 1 to power 100, that makes it 1. Yes or no? Do you all understand this? Sure, no? Say now, if I had two to power 5002. Two to power 5002. And I divided by 31. Two to power 5002 and I divided by 31. I want you to be able to find the remainder of that division. Two to power 5002 when divided by 31. I want you to be able to tell me the remainder. Work on this for some time. I want to find the remainder when 2 to power 5002 is divided by 31, right? Now this 2 to power 5002 can be written as 2 to power 5000 into 2 square, yes or no, divided by 31, right? This is like 4 into, this is 2 to power 5 whole to power 1000 divided by 31, yes or no? This is 4 into 32. This is 32 to power 1000 divided by 32 minus 1, yes or no? Right? So now what I do is I convert these numbers into equivalent algebra. Let me take 32 as x. So then what remainder am I seeking? I'm seeking the remainder of 4 into 30x to power 1000 divided by x minus 1. I'm trying to find the remainder of this division. I'm trying to find the remainder when 4 into x power 1000 is divided by x minus 1. Yes or no? Right? So then this is like remainder of fx, where fx is 4 into x to power 1000 divided by x minus a, where a is 1, yes or no? So we have fx as 4 into x to power 1000, a is 1, so the remainder of fx when divided by x minus a is f of a, so in this case f of 1 is 4. 4 into 1 to power 1000, that makes it 4. Yes or no? So the remainder of this division is 4. Right. Now, shall we proceed? So it's a very powerful tool. Do you realize that? It's not just algebra. Your numbers could be converted into an equivalent algebra and we can find the remainder of that division. A very, very powerful tool. Very powerful tool. Now, some very strong results emerging out of remainder theorem. Let me share those results. Those would be ready reckoners and we should be able to use those results very readily. You can make a note of this first and then I'll go ahead and share some more very critical, vital, important results related to remainder theorem. All right. Can I wipe this off now? Right? Now, there are times you would encounter fx which is of the kind x power n minus a power n, where n is a natural number, where n is a natural number. Now I want to see what happens. I want to see what happens when fx is divided by x minus a. I want to see what happens when fx, which is x power n minus a power n, when it's divided by x minus a. Let me find out the remainder when fx is divided by x minus a. When fx is divided by x minus a, the remainder of this division is going to be f of a. F of a means value of this expression at x equal to a, which is a to power n minus a power n, which is 0. A power n minus a power n, which is 0. Yes or no? That means when fx, which is this, is divided by x minus a, the remainder of this division is 0. That means if the remainder of this division is 0, that means fx is perfectly divisible by x minus a. Yes or no? It means x minus n minus a power n is divisible by x minus a. Right? This is what it means. That means if x this is divisible by this, it means x minus a must be a factor of this. Right? It means x minus a is a factor of x power n minus a power n. Right? For any natural number n. That means x minus a will be a factor of x squared minus a squared. As you can see, this is x plus a into x minus a. X minus a will be a factor of x cube minus a cube. Right? X minus a into x squared plus a x plus a squared. Yes or no? X minus a will be a factor of x power 4 minus a power 4. X minus a will be a factor of x power 5 minus a power 5. Yes or no? Right? Now, can I wipe this off? So, one, x power n minus a power n will always be divisible by x minus a. And x minus a, therefore, will always be a factor of x power n minus a power n for all natural numbers n. For all natural numbers n. Yes or no? This is important. You'll find some very versatile applications around this result. Okay. Can I wipe this off? Now, so for sure, no matter what n is, even or odd, x power n minus a power n will always be divisible by x minus a. X minus a, therefore, will always be a factor of x power n minus a power n. Now, I want to ask the following. Find the condition so that x power n minus a power n is divisible by x plus a. It's divisible by x minus a always. I want to find the condition so that x power n minus a power n is also divisible by x plus a. Right? That means x power n, which is fx, x power n minus a power n, by x minus minus a. The remainder of this division must be zero. If the remainder of this division is zero, that means this is perfectly divisible by x plus a, in which case x plus a must always be a factor of x power n minus a power n. So we want to find the condition so that the remainder of this division, REM, remainder of this division is zero. We want to find the condition so that the remainder of this division is zero. Now, so I'm dividing fx this time by x minus minus a. I'm dividing x power n minus a power n by x minus minus a. Yes or no? What is the remainder of this division? F of minus a will be the remainder of this division. Yes or no? The remainder of this division is going to be f of minus a, right? So which means f of minus a, which is the remainder of this division, x minus London. So f of London will be the remainder. When fx is divided by x minus London, then f of London will be the remainder. This is the remainder. And we want this to be zero. We want this to be zero. That means we want the value of this expression at x equal to minus a to be zero. We want this expression at x equal to minus a to be zero. This is what we want, right? So f of minus a means what? Minus a whole to power n. Minus of a power n must be zero. Right. So which means we want minus a to power n to be equal to a power n. This can happen only when n is even. Only when n is even. Because when n is even, then minus 1 to power n will become plus 1. Yes or no? So this can happen only when n is even. Clear? So two things we have learned: x power n minus a power n for any natural number n will always be divisible by x minus a. That means x minus a unconditionally will be a factor of x power n minus a power n. One. Two, when n is even, this will be divisible by x plus a, and therefore x plus a will be a factor of this expression when n is even. Yes or no? Right? But when n is odd, x plus a will not be a factor of this expression, right? So see, x square minus a square will have x plus a as a factor. X power 4 minus a power 4 will have x plus a as a factor. X power 6 minus a power 6 will have x plus a as a factor. But x power 5 minus a power 5 will have x minus a as a factor, but not x plus a. When n is odd, x minus a will still be a factor, but x plus a will not be a factor of this expression. Is that okay or not okay? Now, can I wipe this off? So that's the first result, which we will use very often. Now, let me look at this expression, fx, x power n plus a power n. N again is a natural number. N again is a natural number. And I want to divide fx by x minus a. I want to divide fx by x minus a. That means I want to divide x power n plus a power n by x minus a. Now what would be the remainder of this division? What's the remainder of this division? When fx is divided by x minus a, the remainder is going to be f of a. F of a. So that's going to be f of a. f of a means the value of this expression at x equal to a, which is a power n plus a power n, which is 2a power n, which is not 0. If a is not 0, if a is not 0, this is not 0. That means x power n plus a power n, if a is not 0, will never be divisible by x minus a. X minus a therefore will not be a factor of x power n plus a power n. Yes or no? Let me carry out a division of fx by x plus a. Let me carry out a division of fx by x plus a. One thing, this x power n plus a power n is never divisible by x minus a if a is not 0. Why? Because the remainder of this division is not 0. Clear? Let me see what happens when fx is divided by x plus a. That means x power n plus a power n, I divided by x plus a. Now, the remainder of this division, remainder when fx is divided by x plus a, x plus a is x minus minus a. When fx is divided by x minus London, the remainder is going to be f of London, f of London. So the remainder of this division is going to be f of minus a. The remainder of this division is going to be f of minus a. X minus London means f of London will be the remainder, right? F of minus a means replace x by minus a. So that's going to be minus a whole to power n plus a power n. Will it always be zero? Right. Only if n is odd will this cancel this. Because when n is odd, this will become minus 1 to power n. That is minus 1 only when n is odd. So this will be 0 only when n is odd. I am assuming a is not 0. Only when n is odd. Isn't it? Do you all understand that? Huh? That means x power n plus a power n is perfectly divisible by x plus a if n is odd. That means x plus a will be a factor of x power n plus a power n when n is odd, right? That means if n is odd, then x power n plus a power n is divisible by x plus a. It means x plus a is a factor of x power n plus a power n. X plus a is a factor of x power n plus a power n when n is odd. See, for example, x cube plus a cube is x plus a into x square minus ax plus a squared. But x square plus a square doesn't have a x plus a as a factor. But x cube plus a cubed, n is 3 odd, will have x plus a as a factor. Yes or no? So when n is odd, x plus a will be a factor of x power n plus a power n. Yes or no? Now, refer to some more divisibility, very general divisibility issues. It may not be related to remainder theorem, but some parity issues. I want you to get comfortable with those things as well. Look at 16a. We want to show that n cubed minus n, where n is a natural number, greater than 1, we'll assume greater than 1, is divisible by 3. N cubed minus 1 is divisible by 3. Let's see how to obtain this. We want to show that 3 divides n cubed minus n. Now, this is n into n square minus 1. N square minus 1 you can write as n minus 1 into n plus 1. So that n minus 1 I write before this, that n plus 1 I write after this. So this is like n minus 1 into n plus 1. Yes or no? Right? Huh? Clear? Do you realize n minus 1, n and n plus 1 are three consecutive integers? Yes or no? Right? N minus 1, n, n plus 1 are three consecutive integers? These are three consecutive integers? If you take any three consecutive integers, one of them will be a multiple of 3. Yes or no? Take any three consecutive integers. 1, 2, 3. This is a multiple of 3. 2, 3, 4. This is a multiple of 3. 3, 4, 5. This is a multiple of 3. 4, 5, 6. This is a multiple of 3. 80, 81, 82. This is a multiple of 3. Right? 103, 104, 105. This is a multiple of 3. Yes or no? Because when look at the tables of 3, they differ by 3, isn't it? So every third number would be a multiple of 3, isn't it? Every third number will be a multiple of 3. So every time you pick 3 numbers consecutive from the number system, exactly one of them will be a multiple of 3 and therefore will be divisible by 3. If you take 5 consecutive numbers, one of them will be a multiple of 5. Yes or no? Right? If you take 2 consecutive numbers, one of them will be even, the other one will be odd. If you take 2 consecutive even numbers, one of them will be a multiple of 4. Say, 2 consecutive even numbers, they will differ by 2. Right? Say, 2 and 4. One of them is a multiple of 4. 80, 82. These are consecutive even numbers. One of them, exactly one of them will be a multiple of 4. Right? 92. Right? So 3, if you take 2 consecutive numbers, one of them will be even, the other one will be odd. If you take 3 consecutive numbers, exactly one of them will be a multiple of 3. If you take 5 consecutive numbers, exactly one of them will be a multiple of 5. If you take 2 consecutive even numbers, one of them will be a multiple of 4. Yes or no? So this is product of 3 consecutive integers. So one of them would be a multiple of 3. Yes or no? And do you realize, if one of them is a multiple of 3, so for sure this is divisible by 3, because exactly one of these numbers would be a multiple of 3, would be divisible by 3. Now, would you also want to believe that of these three numbers, there would have to be at least one number which is even? See, if you take three consecutive numbers, it's possible that two are even, one is odd, or two are odd and one is even. So in a set of three consecutive numbers, there would have to be one even number, right? There would have to be one even number. That means this is not only divisible by 3, this is also divisible by 2, and therefore this will also be divisible by 6. Very good, very good. Right? Got me? Also, I claim that if you take, say, 5 consecutive integers, if you take 5 consecutive integers, the product will be divisible by 120. I claim that if you take 5 consecutive integers, their product would be divisible by 120. Their product would be divisible by 120. How? Say,
The product of 2, 3, 4, and 5.
2, 3, 4, and 5. Let's see. Say, n minus 1 is one number. Before this, say n minus 2 is another number before n minus 1 into n plus 1, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Yes or no? These are 5 consecutive integers and they are multiplied. I claim that this product is divisible by 120. I claim that this product is divisible by 120. Now, see, in this set of 5 numbers, one of them for sure will be a multiple of 5. One of them will be a multiple of 5. So this is divisible by 5. Yes or no? One of them will be a multiple of 3, because even when you take 3 consecutive numbers, one is a multiple of 3. So in 5, obviously, you will find one number which is a multiple of 3. Right? So there would be a number which is a multiple of 3. Now, in 5 consecutive numbers, there'll be at least 2 even numbers. There'll be at least 2 even numbers. And those even numbers would be consecutive. Yes or no? You know what I'm saying? In this set of 5 numbers, there'll be at least 2 even numbers. And they'll be consecutive. So, of the 2 even numbers, one of them will be a multiple of 4. The other one will just be a multiple of 2. Yes or no? So, one of them will be a multiple of 4. The other one will not be a multiple of 4. Yes or no? So, in this set of 5 numbers, there is a multiple of 5. There is for sure a multiple of 3. And in 5 numbers, there would be either 2 even numbers and 3 odd numbers, or 3 even numbers and 2 odd numbers, yes or no? But for sure, at least 2 even numbers, and those 2 even numbers have to be consecutive. Those 2 even numbers have to be consecutive. So if you have 2 consecutive even numbers, one of them will not be a multiple of 4, the other one will be a multiple of 4. So what does this? This is 120. If you take product of 3 consecutive numbers, it will be divisible by 6. If you take 4 consecutive numbers, it will be divisible by 24. 5 consecutive numbers, it will be divisible by 120. In general, let me tell you, and I'll come to a general way of looking at things. First of all, do you understand what factorial notation is? Do you understand factorial? No. Okay. Factorial is only a notation. So, when I say 1 factorial, that's simply 1. If I say 2 factorial, F-A-C-T-O-R-I-A-L. 2 factorial is 1 into 2. 3 factorial means product of all natural numbers up to 3. So that's going to be 1 into 2 into 3. That makes it 6. Right? 4 factorial means 1 into 2 into 3 into 4. That makes it 24. Similarly, 5 factorial is 1 into 2 into 3 into 4 into 5, that makes it 120. Similarly, 6 factorial would be 1 into 2 into 3 into 4 into 5 into 6, that makes it 720, and so on and so forth. Right? So, in a general sense, n factorial is 1 into 2 into 3 into 4 up to n. That's n factorial. Product of all natural numbers up to n is n factorial, right? Product of three consecutive numbers, as we have seen, is divisible by 6, isn't it? N cube minus n, we could write as product of 3 consecutive integers, right? And that's divisible by 6, which is 3 factorial. Product of 5 consecutive integers, we got, if there was 5 consecutive integers, we found that that's divisible by 5 factorial, which is 120. If you take four consecutive integers, their product will be divisible by 4 factorial, 120. If you take three consecutive integers, the product will be divisible by 3. If you take five consecutive integers, their product will be divisible by 5 factorial. As we saw, for three numbers, we saw 3 factorial. For 5, we saw 5 factorial. If you take product of 4 consecutive integers, it will be divisible by 4 factorial. If you take any n consecutive integers, the product will be divisible by n factorial. Write down. The product of any n consecutive integers, the product of any n consecutive integers will always be divisible by n factorial. Let me illustrate a little more to you. Right, you understand this? Product of any n consecutive integers will always be divisible by n factorial. Right, can I wipe this off? Now, in just a quick remark on factorial notation, see, n factorial is 1 into 2 into 3 into 4 into n minus 1 into n, that's n factorial, right? But what is 1 into 2 into 3 into 4 up to n minus 1? Up to n minus 1 will be n minus 1 factorial by definition. So, this is, or n factorial is n minus 1 factorial, right, into n, n minus 1 factorial into n, right? Now put n equal to 1 on both sides. So you get 1 factorial on the left hand side equal to, this is 0 factorial on the right hand side into 1, right? So, this is 1 and this is 1 factorial is 1. This will give us 0 factorial equal to 1. Do you understand whatever I have said? Now, let me illustrate some problems of the sheet. Can I wipe this off? Number 8. Refer to number 8. N is a natural number. 4 to power 5n minus 5 to power 4n we want to show is divisible by 19. We want to show that this is divisible by 19. See how we can use the things that we have learned to establish that this is divisible by 19. Now 4 to power 5 as you can see is 2 squared whole to power 5, which is 2 to power 10, right? So this is 2 to power 10 n minus 5 to power 4 whole to power n. Yes or no? And 2 to power 10, that means this is 2 to power 10 whole to power n. That will make it 2 to power 10 n. 2 to power 10. See, 2 to power 5 is 32. 2 to power 10 is 32 squared. 1024. Right? 5 to power 4. 5 square is 25. So this is 625. Right? So this is like 1024 to the power n minus 625 to power n. Yes or no? Now, I told you x power n minus a power n is divisible by x minus a. For any n, x power n minus a power n will always be divisible by x minus a, yes or no? So this is x power n minus a power n. This will always be divisible by x minus a. 1024 minus 625. Will always be divisible by this, yes or no? X minus a. this is 399. That means it's always divisible by 399. Hmm? But what is that means? 399 is what? 3 into 133? It's always divisible by 3 and 133. But this is like 3. 133 is 19 into 7. So this is divisible by 3, is divisible by 19, is divisible by 7. Yes or no? Got me? All's good? Powerful tool, isn't it? Hmm? Okay. Also realize, look at number 7. How remainder theorem could help factorizing expressions. You know? Can I wipe this off? Clear, no? No confusion? Now, number 7, n is an odd natural number. Alright. And it's given that if you want to show now that a plus b into b plus c into c plus a is a factor of, is a, if n is an odd natural number, we want to show that this is a factor of a plus b plus c to power n minus a to power n minus b to power n minus c to power n. I want to show that every time n is an odd natural number, a plus b, b plus c, c plus a will be a factor of this expression. That means if you try to factorize this, in addition to other factors, this will surely be a factor. This will surely be a factor. So let me first figure out that a plus b is a factor of this expression. That means when I try to factorize this, a plus b must emerge as one of the factors, and then there would be other factors. B plus C, C plus A and other factors, let's say, are appearing here. When n is odd, I want to show that A plus B will always be a factor of this. That means now realize that, and when I factorize something, am I producing an equation or an identity? Identity, identity, identity. That means if I plug in A plus B equal to 0, right hand side is becoming 0, left hand side should also become 0. Yes or no? If I plug in a plus b equal to 0, the right hand side is becoming 0, and therefore the left hand side must also become 0 when a plus b is 0. Right? If the left hand side becomes, if this becomes 0 when a plus b is 0, if this becomes 0 when a plus b is 0, that means a plus b must emerge as a factor of this. Yes or no? Yes or no? You know what I'm saying? Hmm? I'll repeat. No? I'll repeat, I'm saying that if a plus b is a factor of this, then when a plus b is 0, this must be 0, isn't it? That will guarantee that a plus b is a factor. That will guarantee that a plus b is a factor. Right? If a plus b is 0, and if this becomes 0, when a plus b is 0, then a plus b will be a factor of this. Yes or no? See? If a plus b is a factor, very clearly, when a plus b is 0, this must become 0. Right? Let us see. Right? So if a plus b is 0, let us see what happens. This is 0. This is c power n. Right? Hmm? A is minus b. If a plus b is 0, a is minus b. So this is minus b to power n, minus b to power n, minus c power n. If this turns out to be 0 when a plus b is 0, then a plus b must be a factor of this. The c power n gets cancelled with c power n. Oh, yes, yes. So now when n is odd, then minus 1 to power n will be minus 1. If n is odd, minus 1 to power n will be minus 1 into minus 1, that makes it plus 1. So that makes it b power n minus b power n, which is clearly 0. When n is odd, when n is odd, minus 1 to power n is minus 1 into minus 1. So that makes it plus 1 into b power n minus b power n is 0. That means in this expression, if I plug in a equal to minus b, and if this expression is becoming 0 when a is plugged in as minus b, evidently a plus b must appear as a factor in this expression. Yes or no? If this becomes 0 when a plus b is 0, that means a plus b must be a factor of that expression. That means, isn't it? So when a plus b is 0 and n is odd, this is very clearly becoming 0. Therefore, a plus b must be a factor of this expression. Now, if a plus b is a factor, very clearly, what harm has b plus c done and c plus a done to this? No harm. Right? A, B, C occupy identical states in this expression. Do you realize that? The states of A, B, and C are identical in this expression. Right? If the states of A, B, C are identical in this expression, and if A plus B emerges as a factor, then B plus C must also emerge as a factor. C plus A must also emerge as a factor. Yes or no? You don't have to check again. Because of the identical positioning that nature has offered to A, B, and C in this expression. What do you say? So then if A plus B is a factor, then B plus C from symmetry, C plus A from symmetry must also be a factor of this expression, owing to the very looks of the expression, not showing any bias towards A, B, or C. It has no special preference for A, B, and C. So if A plus B has emerged as a factor, so must B plus C, so must C plus A. Yes or no? But only when N is odd. Because only when N is odd, this will become 0 at the behest of A plus B being equal to 0. What do you say? Problem number 9, N is a natural number. We want to find the last two digits of 2 to power 12n minus 6 to power 4n. Now this can be written as 2 to power 6 whole to power 2n minus 6 power 2 whole to power 2n. Yes or no? 2 to power 6 is 64. So this is 64 to the power 2n minus 36 to power 2n. Now, did I tell you x power n minus a power n will be divisible by x plus a if n is even? Yes or no? If the powers are even, then x power n minus a power n will be divisible by x plus a. So, x power even number minus a power even number, it's going to be divisible by x plus a. That means it's going to be divisible by 64 plus 36. That means it's going to be divisible by 100. And if it's divisible by 100, the last two digits must be 0, 0, 0, 0. Right? So is this what you did? All of you? No? You did something else? Yeah, let me see what you did. Apoorv, right? Perfect, perfect. Very nice. Excellent. What did you do? Okay, nice. Nice, nice. Let me see what you did. Oops. Hey, re. Shashwat. Right. Okay, okay, perfect, perfect. Very good. Very good. What did you do? Square nahi hai, it's to power n. So it's to power 2n, not to the power 2. Right? Very nice. So I could see that most all of you have got this right. Very nice. Then number 11. Okay. Number 11. Okay. Number 11. X power n plus 1 minus x power n minus x plus 1 we want to show is exactly divisible by x minus 1 whole square. We want to show that this is divisible by x minus 1 whole square. Right? Now, this expression can be written as x power n into x minus 1 minus x minus 1. Yes or no? Right? I take x minus 1 common and this is x power n minus 1. Right? Now, x power n minus 1 is like x power n minus 1 to power n. So, this must be divisible by x minus 1. Yes or no? So, this is divisible by x minus 1. This is divisible by x minus 1. So, this whole thing is divisible by x minus 1 whole squared. This whole thing is divisible by x minus 1 whole squared. Did you all get it right? Let me see what you did. No, what you have established is that it is divisible by x minus 1. By showing that the remainder f1 is 0, that only proves that it's divisible by x minus 1, not x minus 1 whole square. Right? Let me see what you did. Right. Right. Shashwato, you tried this? Let me take a look. So that will only show that it's divisible by x minus 1. No. This only shows that it's divisible by x minus 1. Right? This does not show that it's divisible by x minus 1 whole squared. So there is a mistake. Right? So, nevertheless, okay. Then, which else? 12. Number 12. N are natural numbers. We want to show that x power m plus 1 is a factor of x power mn plus 1 is a factor of x power mn plus 1. Right? Easy, isn't it? It's easy. See, if I took x power m as some y, this is x power m whole to power n plus 1, right? So this is like y to power n plus 1, right? A function of y, right? And this is y plus 1. I want to show that y to power n plus 1 is divisible by y plus 1. Find the condition, right? Right. So we want to show that y to power n plus 1 is divisible by y plus 1. The condition for which y to power n plus 1 is divisible by y plus 1. Hey, did I tell you x power n plus a power n is going to be divisible by x plus a only when n is odd? Yes or no? So y to power n plus 1 to power n will be divisible by y plus 1 only when n is odd. Only when n is odd. Yes or no? Problem 6, which is like, it's given that x squared minus 1 is a factor of x cubed plus ax squared minus x plus p. Right? That's given. X squared minus 1 is a factor of this expression. Now, we want to find the remainder when this expression is divided by x minus 2. We want to find the remainder when x cubed plus ax squared minus ax plus b is divided by x minus 2. Oh, rather, it's given that the remainder when it's divided by x minus 2 is 15. That's given. Sorry, I'm so sorry. It's given that x squared minus 1 is a factor of this. We want, and it's also given that the remainder when this is divided by x minus 2 is 15. And we want to be able to find the values of a and b. Right? Okay. Now, first of all, for this expression, x cubed plus ax squared minus x plus b. It's given that x squared minus 1 is a factor. That means if you factorize this, you should be able to write this as x squared minus 1 into something. If you factorize this, then you should be able to write this as x squared minus 1 into some other expression in x. If this is a quadratic, degree 2, this must be a linear expression so that the whole thing becomes a cubic expression. Yes or no? This must be an expression of degree 1. Degree 1 and this is degree 2, so that together they make it degree 3, which is the left hand side. Do you realize that? Now, so x squared minus 1 is a factor, which means, you know, x minus 1 into x plus 1 into something. That's how you could write this, which means x minus 1 is a factor of this and x plus 1 is also a factor of this. And is this an equation or an identity? It's an identity. That means now, if you plug in x equal to 1, this must become 0. If you plug in x equal to 1, the right hand side is 0. So the left hand side, which is identical to the right hand side, must become 0. Right? So if you plug in x equal to 1, this becomes 0. Because this becomes 0. Yes or no? Right? So at x equal to 1, suppose I call this expression fx as x cubed plus ax squared minus x plus b. Very clearly, f of 1 must be 0. The value of this expression at x equal to 1 must be 0 because x minus 1 is a factor of this. So this is like 1 plus a minus 1 plus b is 0. This is what I get. 1 plus a minus 1 plus b 0. The value of this at x equal to 1, which means a plus b must be 0. Yes or no? Right? Now, again, x plus 1 is also a factor of this. That means if you plug in x equal to minus 1, the right hand side becomes 0. So the left hand side, which is identical to the right hand side, must become 0 at x equal to minus 1. That means when x plus 1 becomes 0, that means f of minus 1 must also be 0. F of minus 1 must also be 0. What is f of minus 1? Replace x by minus 1. So this will become minus 1 plus a plus 1 plus b is 0, which also gives me a plus b equal to 0. Now, which really means that, you know, I don't have two independent equations to solve for a and b. They are the same. So I can't solve for a and b from this. I'm getting the same equation. They are not independent equations, which means now to solve for a and b, I will have to use this fact. When fx is divided by x minus a, the remainder is going to be f of a, right? So when fx is divided by x minus 2, then the remainder of this division must be f of 2, And f of 2 is given to be 15. So f of 2 is 15, which means f of 2 means 8 plus 4a minus 2 plus b must be 15. This is what it means, right? And this gives me 4a plus b equal to, this is 6 and this will be 9. 15 minus 6, 9. So that's the third equation. So essentially, use 1 and 3 to solve for a and b. Two equations, two unknowns, and you can solve for a and b. All of you can do that. What's the value of a and b? See, if I subtract, 3a is 9. If I do this minus this, then 3a is 9. A is 3. Put a equal to 3. B equal to 9 minus 12 minus 3. Yes or no? B is minus 3. By solving for a and b from equations 1 and 3. Clear? All's good, right? If n is a natural number, we want to show that 49 to the power 9 plus 2 into 4 to the power n plus 49 to power n plus twice 4 to the power n plus 9 to the power n, we want to show is divisible by 5. We want to show that this is divisible by 5. Now, when would a number be divisible by 5? If it ends in 0 or 5. If it ends in 0 or 5, then a number would be divisible by 5. That means if the unit's place is 0 or 5. Now, do you remember this result? X power n minus a power n is divisible by x minus a. For all natural numbers, n, it's divisible by x minus a. That's one result. The second result is, if n is odd, even, if n is even, then x power n minus a power n, in addition to being divisible by x minus a, is also divisible by x plus a. Right? Recall this. If n is even, is it? Or n is even, right? And if x power n plus a power n is divided by x, if n is odd, then x power n plus a power n will be divisible by x plus a. Yes or no? Right? You remember all these results from the previous class? Okay. Now we will actually have to convert this into a combination of these results. That's what we'll have to do now. Because they're all of the forms of x power n, so we'll have to perform some manipulations. Right? Now, see, 49 to power n minus 9 to power n will be divisible by 49 minus 9. That is 40. And we'll have 0 in its units place. We'll have 0 in its units place, isn't it? 49 to power n minus 9 to power n will be divisible by 49 minus 9, that is 40. Yes or no, for all n. So somehow what I do is, I try to bring in a 9 to power n here and adjust it there and see what happens. I'm not sure what's going to transpire, but let's bravely try it out. Okay. What I do is, I write this as 49 to power n minus 9 to power n. Now, I have subtracted 9 to power n, so I'll have to add 9 to power n. So this will become 2 9 to power n plus 9 to power n, that is 3 9 to power n is what would become of this? Yes or no? And this is, see, 2 into 4 to power n is 2 into 2 to power 2n, isn't it? Which is 2 to power 2n plus 1? Which is 2 to power 2n plus 1? So this I can write as 2 to power 2n plus 1. And minus 9 to power n, so I add plus 9 to power n, so this will become 3 9 to power n. This will become 3 9 to power n, and 3 into 9 to power n is like 3 into 3 to power 2n. Good for us. This is becoming 3 to power 2n plus 1. Yes or no? So plus, this is 2 to power 2n plus 1. 2 into 4 to power n is 2 to power 2n plus 1. And 2 into 9 to power n plus 9 to power n to adjust this is also 3 to power 2n plus 1. Do you all understand the manipulation that I have performed here? Okay. One thing, x power n minus a power n, it's going to be divisible by 40. So this will have 0 in the units place. For any natural number n, this will have 0 in the units place. Now, x power n plus a power n, when n is odd, is divisible by x plus a, yes or no? Right? So this is divisible by 5, yes or no? This must be divisible by x plus a, that is 5. X power odd, 2n plus 1 is always an odd number. Do you realize that? Why is 2n plus 1 odd? Because, right, because it's an even number plus 1. Even number plus 1. On either side of an even number, you will find odd numbers. So 2n will always be even. So 1 more than 2n, 2n plus 1 will be odd, and 2n minus 1 will also be odd. So every even number is flanked by two odd numbers. Every odd number is flanked by two even numbers. Right? So 2n plus 1 will always be odd. So x power odd plus a power odd will be divisible by x plus a, that is 2 plus 3, which is 5. So this is divisible by 40. So this is divisible by 5. And this is divisible by 5. So their sum will be divisible by 5. Yes or no? Right? See, this is like a 40k1 kind of a thing. This is like a 5k2 kind of a thing. Right? Because it's an integral multiple of 5. So their sum, when you divide it by 5, will be 88k1 plus k2, which is an integer. Which is an integer. It's perfectly divisible by 5. If two numbers are divisible by 5, their sum will also be divisible by 5. Because this is divisible by 5 and this is divisible by 5. Yes or no? So, this whole thing is divisible by 5. What are the problems from the previous sheet you want me to solve? Number? 16 Bombay. Right? 16 Bombay. N to power 5 minus N, we want to show is divisible by 5. We want to show that n to power 5 minus n is divisible by 5. Now, let's manipulate this expression algebraically. Okay? Now, n to power 5 minus n, I could have written as n into n to power 4 minus 1. Right? This I could have further written as n square minus 1 into n square plus 1. And n square minus 1 I can write as n plus 1 into n minus 1. Yes or no? So this is n into n plus 1 into n minus 1 into n square plus 1. Yes or no? Right? Now, no matter what n is, no matter what n is, the units digit of n, the units digit of n could be 0, or it could be 1, or it could be 2, or it could be 3, or it could be 4, or it could be 5, or it could be 6, or it could be 7, or it could be 8, or it could be 9. These are all the units digits of n. Right? Now, so let's explore each one of them. There are 10 possibilities that we will have to explore. And see that for each of these possibilities, one of them will be divisible by 5. This is all that we need to explore. Yes or no? Right? Now, if n ends in 0, then it is divisible by 5. Then this becomes divisible by 5. Yes or no? So the product will become divisible by 5. If n ends in 0, it's divisible by 5. So this is divisible by 5. And this product will be divisible by 5. So 0 accepted. Now, if n ends in 1, then n minus 1 will end in 0. Yes or no? If n ends in 1, then n minus 1 will end in 0. And if n minus 1 ends in 0, then n minus 1 will become divisible by 5. So then, if n ends in 1, then this becomes divisible by 5, n minus 1, and this product will become divisible by 5. Yes or no? Now, if n ends in 2, right, then n square will end in 4, and n square plus 1 will end in 5. So then this becomes divisible by 5. If n ends in 3, then n square will end in 9, and plus 1, this will end in 0. So this will become divisible by 5. So this is good, this is good. If n ends in 4, then n plus 1 will end in 5. This becomes divisible by 5. This is good. If n ends in 5, no issues. This itself is divisible by 5. If n ends in 6, then n minus 1 ends in 5. Divisible by 5. If n ends in 7, then right, very good. Then this becomes n square ends in 9. And this ends in 0, n square plus 1 will end in 0. If n ends in 8, then n square ends in 4 and this ends in 5. This will become divisible by 5, yes or no? If n ends in 9, then n plus 1 will end in 0 and this will become divisible by 5. So the product will always be divisible by 5, yes or no? All cases considered, there cannot be any other case, right? Please make a note of it. Is there a natural number n? N such that n square plus n plus 1 is divisible by 1955. Is there a natural number n such that n square plus n plus 1 is divisible by 1955? Now again, n will end in 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9. These are the permissible units place of n, right? Now if n ends in 0, then n square will end in 0. So this ends in 0, this ends in 0, so this will end in 1. But if it ends in 1, it will not be divisible by 5. And if it is not divisible by 5, so it will not be divisible by 1955. Because 5 is a factor of 1955. Yes or no? So this case, not possible. N cannot end in 1. Let's look at what happened when n ends in 1. Now if n ends in 1, this will n square will also end in 1. So this will end in 1, 1 and 1. So n square plus n plus 1 will end in 3. Which is again not divisible by 5. So this case also ruled out. Now let's look at 2. If n ends in 2. If n ends in 2, units place, then this ends in 4 plus 2, 6, and this will end in 7, which again is not divisible by 5. So 2 ruled out. Right? If n ends in 3, this will end in 9. And this will end in, this is 1. So 3 and 9, 12 and 1, 13. So this will end in 3. This will end in 3. Which again is not divisible by 5. So this case ruled out. If n ends in 4, this will end in 6. So 4 and then units place of this 6, 10 and 1, 11. This will end in 1. Not divisible by 5. This case also ruled out. Right? If n ends in 5, this ends in 5, n square will end in 5, 5 plus 5, 10 and 1, 11. So this will end in 1. This case ruled out. 6, this will end in 6, n square will end in 6, 12 and 1, 13. So this will end in 3. Not divisible by 5, 7. 7, this will, n square will end in 9, 7 and 9, 16 and 1, 17. That will end in 7. Not divisible by 5. 8, this will end in 4. 4 and 8, 12. And 1, 13. Ends in 3. Not divisible. 9. This ends in 9. This ends in 1. 10 and 1, 11. So this will end in 1. Not divisible by 5. So this is not divisible by 5. How will it be divisible by 1955? Right? Got me?